So this is what it's come to. A pestilence upon my crops. My cow run dry. Trade routes broken down neath the weight of disease. My chicken eaten by wolves. No, I refuse that destiny because I didn't open it from a Duelist of Destiny Yu-Gi-Oh card pack. I shall reclaim my dignity, which shouldn't take long since there isn't much of it. I shall avenge the fallen. I shall set out on a quest, though I might lack the most basic of skills. A quest of riches, catastrophes, true love, vanity, purpose, and just a dash of cinnamon. A quest for cake. Over a span of several days, I had an epic Lord of the Rings-type traveling montage to find the four ingredients that I required. I climbed the cliffs of strife, traveled through the caverns of woe, descended into the Hole of Unhappiness, and emerged into the Forest of 10,000 Riddles. And I traveled across the bridge over troubled waters, which is actually quite pleasant in the spring. But then I realized that my compass was leading me east instead of weest, and that successful survival checks in D&D did not mean that you could actually navigate the real wilderness, and I was doomed to die here next to this log that looked like it smelled like mushrooms. Fortunately, I fell ass backwards into success, stumbling across a small town I called Means to an End. Like Columbus, I had no idea what the inhabitants actually called it, and I really didn't care. Speaking of the inhabitants, I'm pretty sure they were voted video game's most non-friendly quest hub for the years 2018 through 2022. It was not a good feeling. It felt like I was about to take hate crimes seriously, since now they could affect me. But enough on the wheat people and more on the wheat I required, since this town was visibly abundant in it. I found the local shop right beside this donkey. But pleasure was short-lived as one of my orgasms, since this shopkeep refused to take my emeralds for some ungodly reason. I tried to explain to him that they were blood emeralds inherited from my father, and so worth at least twice the price of a normal emerald. But he only seemed interested in something which he referred to as elbow grease. When I inquired as to where I could exchange for this currency, he told me that it stood for the concept of fair benefits for fair work. I could see that there was a language barrier and that this was going to be more difficult than I first surmised. It wasn't until I had resorted to and failed at bribing him with several top quality NFTs I didn't own that I realized the horrendous truth. These people were communists. Da da da! To be quite honest, in hindsight, it all made sense now. The uniform gray clothing, the security tighter than an aging Hollywood starlet's neck skin, and that one dude whom I asked what time it was, and his response was, 246 days since our glorious revolution where capitalistic pig blood ran through the streets. For those unaware of what this means, but feel instinctively scared, much like a chipmunk, please know that your blind, ignorant fear is totally warranted. And not to mention the cornerstone of what this country and Twitter are built upon. But to elucidate things, know that a long time ago, this bald dude helpfully pointed out that to control the masses, all that moguls like myself need to do are to control the means of production, the products of work, and even the ability to do that work. Unfortunately, as is often the case when beautiful, perfect art is made, some very dangerous folks took a very unhealthy interpretation of this. They believed that it meant we should all work together for the greater good, share and share alike. Have no one be above anyone else. Needless to say, this is utter nonsense. However, I wasn't going to earn any Reddit karma debating the point here in a non-echo chamber, so the path forward became clear. To infiltrate their society, manipulate their belief systems, take violent control of the means of production, and instantiate myself as their god king. And if I played my cards right, I could likely maximize both pain and suffering. I started towards my goal instantly with a bit of info gathering, and if World of Warcraft has taught me anything, it's to begin at the local tavern. That, and that simply seeing the color orange can make up for the lack of fulfillment I feel in both my personal and professional lives. It was a drafty and dark place that looked like it was made of the wood of that log that looked like it smelled like mushrooms. Much like the shopkeep, the bartender refused to serve me without first working in the field. On the way out, I noticed that this tree had been dedicated to the memory of Tim, and I just thought that was nice. The field was also a bust. It was far too heavily guarded for any sort of trickery. Finally, I got my break, or so I thought, at the church. Not quite sure what I was expecting to find here, but it certainly was not this. A dude literally giving a literal opiate to the literal masses. I don't know what was in that communion wine exactly, but these fuckers were absolving sins and tripping balls like they were pre-gaming for the end of days. I mean, I can say firsthand, when I took some, I was seeing God and all the other colors of the rainbow and juicy fruit combined. Not sponsored by Juicy Fruit nor the Pope. Warm in the embrace of this transcendental state, I felt safe to realize that what we call reality is simply a mass hallucination by our collective wills. That we are one heart and one mind in the communion of eternity. Unfortunately, the mystery of the string hanging from my sleeve yet eluded me. I awoke several hours later in an alley coated in a thin layer of drool and urine. Don't worry, it was mine. While navigating back to a more familiar part of town, I discovered a small secondhand shop and went inside, hoping I could use it for a quick snort of the gram to fill the void in my life, or at least give me an excuse for a personality. I instantly saw the charm of this rat-infested hole in the wall, filled with shoddy furniture that might snap at any moment and bury me in an avalanche of their worthless antiquities, where naked flames were used in place of up-to-code lighting, primed to conflagrate decades worth of niche comic strips, TV guides, and pornos, where lung space is not meant for oxygen, but instead mold spores, and where this half-blind, impotent codger, who still thinks that balancing a checkbook has some merit, presides over all of it. His name was Mr. Harrington. This painting kind of reminded me of a book by Helen Keller, because whoever made it clearly couldn't see. Mr. Harrington started crying like a bitch when I mentioned this, so I had to buy some crap to shut him up. I bought this useless old paperweight and this practically broken bow. I was curious as to its engraving, but it was too dirty to read, so I decided I'd clean it up when I got a chance. When I grew tired of this man who was a living reminder of entropy and the futility of life, I emerged and noticed that same donkey again, and I'm not crazy, but I'm sure he was giving me the stink eye. It was nearing twilight when I finally navigated back to the inn. This time there were a few regulars, including the pride of the town drunk. Seeing him sparked a plan to sow some discord. I challenged him to a drinking contest, wagering that the loser do the winner's field work tomorrow. The drunk laughed at my delicate, waifish form for a full 7 minutes, which I'm pretty sure breaks the world record for being a douche. But all the same, he accepted. Little did he and all the other mewling fools already patting him on the back know, but I had three things on my side. Tenacity, adaptability, and cheating. I swapped my vodka for water when nobody was looking, but still nearly passed out due to the placebo effect, because I am actually that stupid. But I pulled it out in the end, and once the drunk came to, he agreed to honor the wager and do my share of the field work. Victorious, even though that show's been cancelled for many years now, I walked out into the night. That's when I saw that donkey again, and I was genuinely starting to get creeped out. Was I this floppy-eared motherfucker's type or something? Do I have a musk? Is it mating season? I wandered for a time, stopping when I saw the glow of a campfire. There were sounds of jolly music and raucous laughter, scents of warm stew and roasted meats. It was a wandering caravan parked for the night. These folks seemed friendly enough, but had an odd custom called conversation, an art form that is extinct in most developed nations. When in Rome, so I decided to partake, sat down in the comfort of the campfire as their crone-like matriarch began speaking in her rattly way. There was a spooky meow in the distance to set the mood, which I later learned was just her pet cat named Pussy with 2 fives calling out because she was hungry. She recounted an ancient tale, one told many times before, of a treasure hoard, riches so vast they make you think, maybe money is the key to happiness. and so warred over by dead nations and made larger by each of their lustful kings. Potions of chaos and religious icons that could raise men from the dead. She revealed that it was eventually stolen from this world, lost to another entirely, where it is coveted by an undying beast of diamond tooth, obsidian scale, and violet flame. Then she prophesied, an unlikely champion come from a distant land unexpectedly would rise from obscurity. Through his skill in battle and noble heart alone, he would slay the usurping beast, take the riches, and distribute them amongst the needy, progenerating 10,000 years of prosperity and peace. Thankfully, this legendary dude turned out to be some jackass named Larry. Had literally nothing to do with me, because that sounded like a lot of work, and like I would have been expected to donate my appearance fee to the charity I'm raising money for. They gave Larry some magical sword of untold wonder, and he fucked off on his epic quest. I eventually passed out under the weight of foreshadowing, and when I awoke, they had gone, like the rain on the mountaintops and my kidney stone. I ate some breakfast bread I'd stolen from Mr. Harrington the other day, and then went to beat the living shit out of him because it was slightly stale. Mr. Harrington, being a genuinely kind soul, aka stupid, instantly apologized and offered my pick of anything within his shop as repayment. I took another sift through the refuse in his store and noticed that he had some old printing press parts and an unexpectedly empty basement. So I cooked up a plan to help my conquest, took up occupancy in the basement, and turned it into a printing press with some of the old junk. Over the course of the next few days, I printed copies of Atlas Shrugged and distributed them amongst the populace to open their minds to a better way of life, using them like a Bible against a vampire. But these vampires suck out freedom. I also built a meth empire, but can't elaborate because I don't want this video to go on too long. Then one day, when I was minding my own business destabilizing this civilization, my door blew up and in rushed a ton of enforcers. Once the smoke cleared, I saw that donkey again. He had led these thugs right to me, for he was a member of the Thinking Police, tasked with stamping out all common sense and notions of personal ownership. I underwent many days of interrogation, but never torture, since I told them everything they wanted to know about my capitalistic agenda without hesitation, since I could of course not feng shui ideals like resolve, conviction, and honor into the design of my safe space. My trial slash execution soon followed, where I would be proven not hanged until hanged. I was optimistic there would be a hung jury. My crimes, or as I like to call them, creative interpretations of justice, were read aloud. These included over 1,000 accounts of treason, sedition, hate speech, distribution of profane materials, illegal sale of a controlled substance, theft, gaining access to the apparatus of the state to effect ruinous change, just to name a few. An eyewitness attested that she had seen me eating a double bacon cheeseburger, despite not contributing to the production of the wheat, dairy, or beef industries. She said, quote, "He was eating it while his oily top-shelf skin cream glared in the sun, as he rode his sports car with the roof rolled down, laughing like a rich, smug son of a bitch, while all the while simultaneously selling stocks on his smartphone, so as to undermine the overall health of the economy." When my time came, I ascended the scaffold to deliver my defense slash final words. That's when I realized that the executioner slash judge was the villager with whom I had shared a lover's tryst. But like my meth empire, I did not have time to showcase it. "You were so right. It is beautiful here. Care for another apple?" As the noose was fitted around my neck, I looked out into that crowd and told them that I was not their enemy. Told them that every man, woman, child, and even communist is entitled to some basic rights. The right to the American dream, which is no longer working hard to get what you can only earn, but instead manipulating stupid people via the least amount of effort possible. The right to worship as you choose, replacing God and Jesus with Rick and Morty. The right to make a constitutional issue out of not being allowed to scream obscenities in a park on a sunny day. The right to be a foremost expert on any subject after reading half of the first sentence of a Wikipedia article. And the right to abandon your so-called loved ones to a nursing home once they grow too old and inconvenient. God bless you and God bless Slap Mountain. As the oxygen left me, I became lightheaded. My life flashed before my eyes.
whom you think you're dealing, but you're not getting a penny of child support. He's not mine. I wore a condom. Good night.
Suddenly, the pressure left my neck and my aching lungs breathed deep. Once reality clarified, I realized I was being carried away on the back of that donkey who had ratted me out. He quickly explained that his name was Donkey, like all other donkeys in a society that crushes individualism. He said that my account of capitalism just now had moved his Bolshevik heart, and he had saved me to make a deal. In return for my life, I would teach him the secrets of entrepreneurship and tax evasion. Even though that is, of course, redundant. I was so proud I could have cried, but instead puked because I had nearly just died. As I bent over to vomit, I grabbed onto some wheat by mistake, tearing them away totally accidentally in our escape. Meaning that by complete happenstance, this episode wasn't a huge waste of time, and I was one step closer to my actual goal. And no after-credit sequence could remove any of that optimism.
Hi. Huh.